Good morning, friends. Nice to see you after a week. And yes, today we are in continuation with our National Economic Survey series. Today we would be starting off with the fourth chapter on the NES, where the emphasis of data as a public good is being presented as an idea. So if you look at the title of the chapter, data of the people, by the people, and for the people, something very similar to what Mr. Lincoln said about democracy. Sincere thanks to Mr. Sundar Rajan for his outstanding contribution in trying to understand the National Economic Survey and present it in the manner he's done for the day. This is the agenda, friends. So we're talking about the economics of data. So how to monetize data. This is something, it's a common jargon most of us would have seen tech companies saying. So data monetization and data as a public good, economies of scale of data generation, distinctive sets, integration, government platforms, and a couple of initiatives being done by state governments and the Digital India Initiative. Moving on, friends. So as we are aware that there's been significant explosion of information, rather too much of information being made available at this point in time. And majority of the underprivileged, though they have access to the internet or a smartphone, you would say not necessarily the internet, have very minimal digital footprints. Now, the way data needs to be looked at is data throws up significant outcomes. For example, in the lending space, today a social media behavior pattern is being used to understand a person's integrity, ability to repay, because all said and done, your papers could suggest his ability, whereas the intention to repay is something which is derived from the psychology of the person to whom you are lending. So right from scrapping someone's social media profile or understanding his digital behavior, data scientists have been able to map a person's profile based on which lending decisions are being made. The government in its wisdom has thought, instead of looking out for opportunities to bring down subsidies or bring down unwanted or leakages in government benefits, why don't we use data as a mechanism to offer solutions to larger public problems? So some of the marginal benefits what they felt was evidence-based policy, because most of the policy decisions are being taken on random surveys. So here you would have precise evidence-based policies, increasing accountability in public services, targeting welfare schemes, nationally integrated markets. The ENAM is a national agricultural market, more like a marketplace for agricultural commodities and innovative products. Given the explosion in data, what currently happens is the cost of gathering, storing, and processing as well as dissemination of data is significantly decreasing by the day. We all are aware of the cost of a 10 GB hard disk some time back and what it takes to buy a 2 or a 4 terabyte hard disk is now cheaper than what it was then. So data is a public good. So this is a concept where they felt data needs to be made available to public, not only for the government to take decisions, but even for public businesses to take some informed decision making. We'll be seeing in the ensuing chapters, possibly today as well, as to how certain critical data points will help businessmen, entrepreneurs, as well as general public to take some informed decisions. So there are several areas where data is not actually being harnessed. The private sector, especially you look at most of the large guys, I mean, Amazon or Flipkart or Paytm are classic examples of harnessing data for expansion of business opportunities. The government has felt its intervention is required to end where the private may not necessarily be making an investment, but more not necessarily for commercial terms, but also from an access perspective. The government as well, it's important for the government to intervene and make that investment. So to ensure that there is socially optimum amount of data is harvested, used, the government needs to interfere, provide the correct incentive framework for private sector to set up data warehouses. ENAM is one of the classic examples where the government has thought data as a public good. And there are concerns at this point in time around the privacy aspects. Classic example is what happened with Aadhaar, because Aadhaar is regarded as one of the most strongest and the most integrated social security scheme globally. But we did have the Supreme Court coming in saying you cannot make Aadhaar mandatory, it violates individual privacy and stuff like that. So that's another consideration which needs to be had in mind. When it comes to economies of scale for data generation, today, if you look at, there are multiple data points through which data can be obtained, right? From your transport data to your consumption data to your web browsing data to your spending patterns through your banking patterns. So there are like a zillion data points available to take decisions. So data is more useful, as we would have studied in economics, where you're able to use it or combine it with other data. Classic example is your correlation, right? I mean, the correlation factor is a relationship between two or multiple variables. Now, but for that, we need to have a critical mass. I mean, simple as we say for a survey, right? The exit polls which come on board, you need to have a critical mass of population. And this also needs to be studied over a particular period of time. Now, thus far, what's happened is collection of this data was a challenge. But today, the collection, given the significant digital dissemination which has happened, collection of data is not that serious a challenge. Some of the distinct data sets collected by the government, one is your administrative data, the survey data. Administrative data typically talks about the birth and death and tax records of the population, the marriage records, etc. Survey, which happens by the National Statistical Office, the census, which is being taken periodically. Transactions data, the ENAM, the UPI. Institutional data, the schools, hospitals, etc. These are just imagine, friends, how if we are able to correlate or mix and match both these or multiple data sets, the outcome could be outstanding. Classic example is what's happened in London. Significant amounts of data such as timetables, service status, and disruption are available. Open travel data can support travel apps real time, reduce uncertainty and lower information costs, supporting growth in tech economy and increase use of public transport. So what it also does is, let's say a senior citizen concession is to be obtained. By merely linking his birth records with his transport records and his employment records, a senior citizen can be automatically offered a concession on the route which he or she takes to travel for work. You don't need to unnecessarily go create a card for senior citizen, expect him to give proof again, go run to the government offices 4-5 times. All those things are done away by sheerly integrating data. And what the government has also done is, the federal government and the public agencies should publish their data online in a machine-readable format. So this also helps private enterprises and the public to take informed decisions. So US government has made 138,000 data sets available to public. Classic case could be the number of schools in a locality. Now, today, let's say there's an entrepreneur who wants to set up schools. He would know the population to the number of schools data at the, I mean, in his fingertips. There is no need for him to conduct a detailed market survey or, you know, spending a lot of time, resources and energy in getting this in place. It happens instantly. Now, this is how data can enable. Just imagine the classic use case of what I gave was for an entrepreneur. For the government, there are a zillion opportunities. We can bring down our subsidy leakage by almost 100% the way it is today. Bring down the subsidy bill by at least 40-50%. So now all what is required is for the government to act as an enabler to make it actually work. So the government, the proposal by an NES is to have an open government data platform that allows citizens to access government data in machine-readable forms. It also helps government officials to make better decisions. And it throws open the government data to public multiples, to the public, multiplies the number of number of people analyzing and deriving insights from the data. Now, to enable the government to actually solve problems, the Ministry of Human Resource recently initiated a Smart India Hackathon, which is an open innovation model to discover new disruptive technologies that could solve India's most pressing problems. See, classic example, friends, there is a study which says that the aging population, the population aging in India is going to increase significantly because the fertility rate is coming down. It's lower than the population replacement rate. The rate of growth of population has come down by more than half compared to what it was in 1970s and 80s. Now, this is an information which is required for multiple stakeholders. If you are in the public health and welfare department, you really need to ensure that you are going to increase the number of beds available for catering to the increased demand of aging population over the next 5 or 10 years. You can't do it because these are all large projects which takes time. Now, this is what an open government data platform can enable. Now, a classic example is what the Telangana government has done. They've taken 25 data sets using a common identifier like the name of an individual, which is typically like what we do for a CIBIL, as you can do. And this data set is being contributed by multiple agencies. And this is more like an aggregate exercise. Classic example is the police department would be contributing some data, the education ministry, the utilities ministry, the tax ministry. So now all these will be giving data, but based on certain 2 or 3 common parameters, could be an Aadhaar number, could be the name with a PAN number, whatever be the parameter. Then that particular individual's data is linked to his relatives. Now, every ministry has a right only to upload. They cannot edit the databases of different ministries. Now, with this, what happens, at the click of a button, you will now be able to see the entire history of a person digitally. So imagine what it can do to multiple services. If you are in the business of FMCG, you can target who requires what. If you are in the government business or an NGO, you can target your efforts at a very specific set of population. All this is now being made possible by just sharing government data using a common identifier. Sorry. Now, so this is what the government is the idea which is suggested. The first steps to transform the data infrastructure is gathering data, storing, processing, and disseminating, something which we are fairly used to, especially given the fact that being accountants and used to large financial data. The Digital India Initiative, which the government has always been harping on, it's a very interesting and an ingenious suggestion, where the government is trying to crowdsource data entry volunteers and where they can earn cash reward. It's more like a freelancing opportunity for professionals, for people who can work as data entry operators, earn certificates, and also make a living out of it. Now, the program also features a mobile app so that you don't necessarily need a computer or a laptop to work with. It's a fascinating incentive, friends, primarily because these are poor people who can now work literally from home, from wherever they at this point. The Manrega, another classic case for. So it's accessible by stakeholders. It captures a complete flow of Manrega. In the spirit of the citizens' right to information, system makes available documents, muster rolls. Of course, names and other issues could definitely be hided given the privacy concerns. Language, again, being the central government sponsored program, the data is now available in multiple regional languages. The government also proposes to have a national health registry, so which they intend to use more from targeting the healthcare benefits. And the registry could have multiple components like your hospitals, the syndromes for various ailments, the immunization information, electronics. So it could be a case where the medical insurance for a person or for a child who's undergone immunization at various stages could be far lower than someone who's not. So the cost of offering services could significantly come down both from the government as well as from the public perspective. Now, so what is now required is we need to have a centralized data architecture, which has standardized data capture mechanisms, and which would effectively end up collecting or aggregating data from various ministries. So the case for cooperative federalism should definitely actually be working in this case for this system to succeed. And the benefits, as we have seen, one, the government would be able to provide targeted welfare schemes. The private sector can commercially harness this data. And the citizens at large, for those who are service-oriented or even to take certain sensible decisions based on pertinent data instead of a wild guess, this would definitely be of great help. assistance.